Morning.
Morning.
Very beautiful, huh? What a wonderful way to start. Well, I'm glad to see you all in the house of God today. It's good to see faces that I haven't seen in a while. How about you? It's good to look around and see some faces you haven't seen in a while, right? It's good to see the faces you've seen in a while also. And we like them faces too. Pastor, it's good to have you with us this morning. God bless you, sir. Our congratulations are with you as you have that new achievement. Forgive me if I'm out of place, but our pastor Edgar has added another achievement to his pursuit of God, and he had a graduation ceremony on Friday. So we honor. We were all still so impressed that time and again you spoke to us with that fervent heart, and how you handled the word with such honor and respect, and you've given that to us. So we acknowledge that in your life. Amen. And Esteban and Virginia, you know, you are so much on our hearts and in our prayers. To see you walk in the door is a joy for us. So I don't know what you had to do to get here. But you got it. Yeah. For all of you, as you know, I know sometimes it's easy to get up, sometimes it isn't easy to get up, but to see you all. Jennifer, I had a conversation with you. I know you were in that accident on Tuesday. Our prayers are with you that God heal your body, as the rest of us who have the ailments in our bodies. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Sister Keeter, it's good to see you, although you're trying to hide, but I can see you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's been a while, Kathy. It's good to have you back. If you look in your bulletins, the title of today's message is Son of Man. Son of Man. And when you look at all of the titles that are given to our Lord Jesus Christ, there are many. Son of God, Son of Man, Savior, Redeemer, Everlasting Father, Almighty God, Prince of Peace, Wonderful Counselor. Amen. But today, we want to talk just a little bit about the title that he has as Son of Man. Perhaps one of his most beautiful. And as Sister Sandra said, on Tuesday and Friday nights, we are studying the Gospel of Luke. So, this opportunity for all men and all women, you choose your day, men Friday, women Tuesday. Basically, the clarification on that one. And Pastor Phil Sr. chose the book for the year. And I believe, in that Gospel of Luke, it's really ordained by God that we study that book, because in that is where we really see a good picture of the Son of Man. Amen, Pastor? The Son of Man. And in the Gospel of Luke, what we notice is, we notice the wonderful, compassionate heart of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and how he primarily comes to bring equality to all. He liberates the women, he raises up the poor, he gives strength to the weak, and he ushers in the Gospel of Luke, a whole new humanity. A whole new humanity which breaks down all of the walls of division, all of the classes that separate us, the genders included, and he brings a unity to all of humanity. It is the beginning of a new humanity. Amen. Where Jesus Christ himself is honored by his Father to be given the same title as you and me. God Almighty, Son of God, he wants the same title that you and I have. He also wants to be called a Son of Man. He wants to be known as a human being. Can you believe that? Can you believe that? Because I don't know if I can believe that. That God looked out on his beautiful creation, and he saw such beauty, and he said, hey, I want to be numbered among them. I want to have the same title they have. They are called Son of Man. I want to be called Son of Man. And as a matter of fact, in the Gospel of Luke and through all the Gospels, Son of Man might be listed 88 times in the four Gospels, and it was Jesus who used that title on himself. No one called him Son of Man but himself. Huh. And as they would refer to him as Son of God, he would talk back to them with the reference to himself as, yes, 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 I am the Son of Man. Huh. show us the beauty and the power and the glory of his crown creation, mankind. And you know, he came back, and one of the reasons why he came back was to show the entire human race just how beautiful you are, just how wonderfully the human race has been created and never, never, never lost it. Only in our own minds and through our own eyes of understanding sometimes we don't see the glory. You don't have to say amen to that one. But the Lord Jesus Christ has come to the earth to seek and to save those who were lost. He referred to himself as the Son of Man. I am, he said, the Son of Man, and I have come to the earth to seek and to save those who are lost. And I say, Lord, me first, Lord, me first. And then you may get on that. Oh, you're bumping me, huh? He was the only one who referred to himself as the Son of Man. He said, don't forget who I am. Don't forget my mother. He said, Mary is my mother. Don't forget my human mother. So when we look into the Gospel of Luke, and we study it this year, we see that in the Gospel of Luke, we have the introduction of first of all, the breaking of the silence that has existed for 400 years, where after 400 years of silence, there's finally a mighty, mighty, mighty archangel by the name of Gabriel that appears to a seemingly unknown priest until this episode by the name of Zacharias. And Zacharias is in the temple doing what he's supposed to do in the church on a Sunday. He's just going about his business when all of a sudden, there is a mighty angel from heaven by the name of Gabriel that comes and visits him. And he calls him and says, Zacharias. He says, I'm about to do something new in the earth today. New in the earth today. And the beautiful thing is when he comes to say that, he says, I'm going to do something new in the earth and new in all humanity. But he says this to you. He says this to me. He says, but I'm going to do something new to you first. And I say, thank you for not forgetting me. Because as much as God loves the world and is going to save the world, he doesn't lose the small things. He always starts with you. He says, you first. He says, I'm going to bless the world, but I'm going to bless you first. And he says, Zachariah, you're going to have a child. And your wife Elizabeth, who has cried out for a child, who has not had a child up until her old age, he says, in your old age, you will have a child. And Elizabeth's shame was going to be taken away because the Son of Man, the Son of God, has heard her cry and said, you're going to give birth to a child, a son. And the angel said, you're going to give him a name. Does anybody remember the name that the angel Gabriel told Zechariah? Does anybody remember the name?
Yeah.
He said, you will give him the name John. The name John. And after the child was born and it was time to dedicate the child, they brought the child to the temple and they asked Elizabeth because Zechariah couldn't talk. And they said, Elizabeth, what will be the name of the child? And I believe they said, is his name Zachariah? Because they still did it back in those days. It was going to be Zachariah Jr., you know that. And Elizabeth says, his name is John. And quickly they looked away from Elizabeth. Okay, thank you. They said, Zachariah, what is his name? And after 9 months, the tongue of Zachariah was loosed. And the first words he says, he didn't say name him John. He made a declaration. He said, his name is John. Which means beloved. Oh, the new humanity was going to be loved by God. His name is John. You are loved, dearly loved, beloved by your Creator. New humanity. And after that game, that angel Gabriel was busy that time of year. It seems like he did nothing for 400 years, and all of a sudden he had all this work to do. He saw Elizabeth, and he had to go take a visit to Mary. He said, excuse me, Elizabeth, I got another schedule I got to keep here. And isn't it like those all, sometimes we got nothing to do with God, we think nothing's going on, I'm bored or whatever, and all of a sudden, boom, I got no time. So the archangel Gabriel said, excuse me, Elizabeth, I have one more appointment today. And he went to a young woman by the name of, does anybody know her name?
Mary.
And he said, Mary, you're going to have a child too. The only difference is Mary was not an old woman, Mary was a very young woman. First, Gabriel appeared to an old man, and then he appeared to a young woman. And he said to this woman, young woman, you're going to have a child too. It's going to be a virgin birth. Immaculate. Help me out.
Conception.
Conception. And he said, you're going to name his name Jesus. Because he will save his people from their sins. Hallelujah. And I love defining words because he says, I'm going to save your people. I'm going to save my people from their separation. What has separated you from God, the lover of your soul. Whatever has lied to you that says that your God does not love you. He's appeared upon the scene and says, I don't know what lie you've been living under. But he says, I've always loved you. And he sent forth Jesus to separate, to save you from that separation. And he said, not only do I love you, I love all of mankind. I always have. And I always will. Amen?
Amen?
You're going to have a son, and his name is Jesus. Now remember that John the Baptist was a priest. He was a priest. And usually the priests, they didn't start their ministry until the age of 30. So at the age of 30, as every priest before him, his father and his grandfather and his great-grandfather, when John the Baptist became 30 years old, it was his turn to be the priest. And Zechariah went to the temple to be the priest, and he did his duties in the temple. But this was something new. This was a new priesthood that was born. So when John the Baptist was 30 years old, he didn't go to the temple. Where did he go? He went to the wilderness. He went to the multitudes. I think he went to seek and to save those who were lost. And he went to the wilderness and the dry places, and he went to the masses, and then he began his priesthood, because he was a priest. And as we discussed on Bible study night, John the Baptist had a six-month ministry, 6 months, 30 years in, 30 years and a half out. They beheaded him 6 months in. We still talk about his ministry to this day. And Jesus was the one who began, John was the one who began a new priesthood. And you know, as John was on the banks of the Jordan River, baptizing and saving, he said, as Jesus approached, he said, what did he say? He said, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. And John said, you might think that I'm mighty and I'm doing great things, as mighty as you think I am. But what he says, he said, I'm not even worthy to unloose the latchet on his sandals. You know why? Because that's how great he is, and that's how great and how much he loves you. That's how much care he is so great. What made him so great? His love for you and his love for humanity, that he wanted so much to be called, yes, the Son of God, but also call me the Son of Man. Then let me be numbered among you. Amen.
Praise God.
Praise God. And you see in the Gospel of Luke, after 400 years of silence, a whole new humanity, a whole new priesthood, a whole new God that has been seen clearly, that has only been marred through the ages. And the ministry came to the whole world. So not only did John begin his priesthood in the world, in the wilderness, by the streams of the Jordan, but so did Jesus. Jesus didn't appear in the temple. You know why? You know why? Because he was the temple. He was the temple. Everywhere he went was the temple. Yeah, he said greater than a temple. Is he a greater than Solomon? Is he a greater, greater, greater? He was the temple. And, you know, even as we begin the Gospel of Luke, you know, first there was an old order. First the angel Gabriel, he appeared to an old man. Because back in the day, you know, even as you read the customs of old, even when they numbered folks, they would only number the men. You know, the women didn't have a class, they were a lesser class in the ancient world, in the archaic world, in the ignorant world. And I'm not really pointing at gender, I'm really pointing at spirit and soul. But you see, the angel first came to the old man and he said, listen, the old man, you're going to have a child. You're going to have a child. He came to the old order first. And he said, you get something new, you're going to be birthed in an old order. But then what's interesting is after he talked to an old man, you see the gospel I played already, then he went to talk to a young woman and gave the same message. He said, young woman, you're going to give birth to the Son of God. And all of a sudden, the woman had a voice. The woman had a voice. The woman had expression. The woman was going to give birth to the things of God. And I'm not looking at gender. Don't ever think I'm looking at gender. Gender is just a picture. It's not man or woman in Christ Jesus. It's either male or female, bond or free. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. What the picture is here, it's a picture. The woman in Scripture is always a picture of the soul of man. The soul of man. Because sometimes we used to think that our souls were just no good. Sometimes we used to think there's nothing good in the soul of man. I don't know. Maybe you thought that from time to time. I don't know. I'm not accusing you of anything. I'm just thinking. Sometimes we think there's nothing good in the soul of man. So therefore, in our ignorance, in our churches, we think we got to get rid of the soul of man. We got to get rid of all of the the emotions, all of the characters of a person. We got to make bricks and we got to build this temple. And you got to act like this and you got to do this. It's going to be A, B, C, D, E, F. And if you go outside that, you're going to start all over. Because we didn't believe there was any redemptive power, any redemptive nature in the woman, in the soul. Like you got to get that soul under control, get those emotions under control, get that intellect under control. And then God says, no, 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 I'm going to redeem humanity. I'm going to give birth to it. And your soul, my woman, your woman, is going to give birth to God. And now my emotions, my intellect, my emotions, my feelings are going to, in my own way that God has created me, express who God is.
Amen.
So now you're going to see God is in the way that God shows me. And then I'm going to see God the way God shows you. And you're going to show me God in your way. And you're going to show me God in your way. Because the soul is where you get expression to the Spirit of God. There's nothing wrong with the soul. You just need Christ to redeem.
Amen.
And then you can use your emotions. You can use your characteristics because we're all different, right? We're all different. Some of us are crazy, right? You gotta look down when you say that. Some of us are crazy. Some of us are sane. That's when you look in the mirror. Some of us are sane. But God. In his infinite power, we use your craziness to express all that. Because God created you to be you. Sometimes we don't know how to act like God. Just be you. Be truly you. Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
It ain't hard. It's easier than we ever thought. But I found out that God told me just to be me. Well, that's easy. I can do that. Now I don't care if you like me or don't like me. I don't care. Well, all right, I'm turning the tables. I don't care if you act like an idiot. It's okay. Because that's you. Well, God can use that. Use it. But God can use that. Okay, we definitely got off track here. But in this new humanity, he says, I'm going to speak to the woman now. And the woman is going to be redeemed and set free and get an expression to who God is. And now you're free to be you by the power of the Spirit of God that lives inside you. Thank you, Jesus. It could be very boring if we were all the same.
Amen.
You'd be free to express what God causes you to express. It might be like something that no one has ever seen or heard before. That's the whole purpose of it. That's the whole purpose. You ever try to do what was right? You ever try to act like somebody else? Okay, they're doing this, and it works for them, but it just doesn't work for you. Anybody ever been there?
Yeah.
I've tried many times. I've tried many times. It's like I heard that preacher do it, and it really impacted me. And then I come up to try to do it. It's like I'm saying to myself, of course, nothing. Nothing.
Because it wasn't me.
Yeah.
So, after 400 years of silence, God is going to give birth to a new humanity. So, if you would, if you open up your Bibles to the Gospel of Luke, let's turn to the 19th chapter. I have another story I want to read to you. The very beginning of 19, it's the story of Zacchaeus. It says that Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see Jesus. And already this moves the heart of a loving God, because he wanted to see Jesus. He knew he was no good in the eyes of everybody else, but he wanted to see Jesus. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he couldn't because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. Now all the people that were around saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner," they said. Jesus was going to be the guest of a sinner. Zacchaeus was a chief tax collector, a publican, if you will, a traitor to the Jewish nation. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, he said, "Look, Lord, here and now I give away half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I'll go back and pay him four times the amount." And Jesus said to Zacchaeus, he said, "Today salvation has come to this house. Because this man too, this publican, this tax collector, this man too is a son of Abraham." And then here we go, Jesus refers to himself as the Son of Man. He says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save those who were lost." Amen. See, the first thing he does is refers to himself as the Son of Man. And look at the beautiful picture that it was no mistake that he was going down the street. Listen, Jesus knew he was going to see Zacchaeus that day. He knew it. He knew that there was a whole crowd of people. But perhaps he was just going there to see one person that day, one man, one woman. Maybe it was me, maybe it was you. He knew in the masses, he knew he was going to touch one person that day. I know we want to fill the stadiums that we can, but sometimes it's just one person. That the God of all creation created billions and billions of people. He just wants to call your name, and he wants to see you. And although there's a sea of faces, and you think you're lost in the sea of faces, man, you can be on the bottom with 1,000 people on top of you, and he sees you.
Amen.
He sees you. And Zacchaeus went up in that tree because he wanted to see Jesus. You know why he wanted to see Jesus? He kind of like figured, if I can look into the face of Jesus, maybe he'll look back into my face. You ever pull one of them? I go to look at somebody, not because I can't see him. I can see him. I just want them to see me. I'm doing like this. I can see him. I just want to make sure they see me. And then I pretend like I was just trying to see him. I just wanted them to see me. I'm sorry, it was about me. Do you see me? That's all I care about right now. I need something. I know you said I'm a publican. I know I'm hated by all people. My own people hate me. I'm lost and I can't save myself. I've fallen and I can't get up. I have fallen and I can't get up. You know what I'm talking about. I've fallen and I can't get up.
So he wanted to see Jesus. I believe he wanted Jesus to see him, because he went up into the tree. He went up into the tree, and as Jesus passed that way, he said, Zacchaeus, he said, come down from here. He said, Zacchaeus, you don't need to go in no tree. I saw you before I came here. I saw you. He said, I came for you. I came for you. I hear your cry. I know your name. Zacchaeus didn't introduce himself to Jesus. Jesus knew his name. Yes. He said, Zacchaeus, come down from there. You are the reason why I'm here. And he says, I'm going to have dinner with you in your house. And immediately, Zacchaeus is melted by the love of the Son of Man. He is melted by his touch and his compassion. He says, Jesus saw me? He knew my name? He's talking to me? Because he was a short man. You know, sometimes we all feel a little short. I'm not important. I'm not so significant. There's more important people than me. I don't. Jesus has better things to do. He's a short man. And Jesus said, I see you, Zacchaeus. And he says, come down. I came for you today. And of course, there was the murmuring crowd, right? And Jesus says, no. Is this too? Is the son of Abraham? Whoever it might be in life, maybe it's you at times, where you say, I'm not worthy to be called a child of God. I'm not worthy to be called a child of God. And maybe sometimes we might look into the faces of those around us and say, well, maybe they're not a child of God either. But the Son of Man doesn't say that. Son of Man never says that. Never says that. The Son of Man says, no, this too, the worst of the worst, part of the covenant. The worst of the worst belongs to me. And although the world may talk about you, he says, you, you're mine. And the world might hate me, but all of a sudden, hey, God loves me. It's all right. It's all right. And I know that the Lord wants us to give us that revelation of just how much he loves us. He loves us so much, he's the only one that referred to himself as the Son of Man. They went to him and said, Son of God? He said, yes, Son of Man, I am. I am the Son of Man. And the love of God melted his heart, and he repented of everything, and he said, I'll give it all. I'll give my wealth and possessions. He didn't need a sermon on what to do. He didn't need any 10 steps to get his life right with God. He just needed to be loved. He just needed somebody to look into his face. He just needed somebody to call his name. And he said, that's what I wanted. That's what I wanted. Do you see me? Do you know me? I'm lost. I can't get out of this mess. I know you told me to stop doing this. I can't stop doing this, okay? I just can't. Well, Jesus came and said, Zacchaeus didn't even acknowledge, he acknowledged none of that stuff. He acknowledged none of it. He just said, we're going to have dinner today, is that all right? And the man was melted and changed in a moment forever. Gave away what he thought was valuable, he really knew it had no value. So the only thing valuable in this life is my Savior, my Lord, the lover of my soul. He knows my name. He wants to be with me. I want to be with him. I want to be with him because he loves me. And his love caused me to give away everything that I thought had value. Everything in life that I fight for, that I hold on to, that I think is so precious. When I see and you see Jesus, it's like, wow, that's everything. That's everything. Amen. Jesus himself, he said, I am the Son of Man. I came to seek and to save those who are lost. Yeah. If you're in the Gospel of Luke, and if you want to turn, I just want to read two more passages. And the first one is Luke chapter 4. And you know, even when I asked the Lord, and maybe I asked for you, maybe I asked with you, I said, Lord, When you say you want to do something new, when you say you want to birth a new humanity in the earth today, because I do believe we're living in a period where God has broken the 400 years of silence and he wants to begin to speak again. He wants to give new dreams and new visions and a new idea of humanity in the world. He says the old one has been fulfilled. I'm going to give you a new one now. And the new one's always bigger and greater than the old one, right? So I asked God, and as you do, I said, Lord, I need to see the big picture of it. I don't want to get caught in my small world. I said, I need to see the big picture of it. Lord, what are you doing in the world? And even in reference to the ages of time, what are you doing? What do you want to do? What do you want to do through me? What do you want to do through us? What do you want to do in the world today that will touch the individual, that will touch governments and nations? What do you want to do? I want to see the big picture of it. And then I ask the second question, and the second question is just as important. I say, not only do I want to see the big picture, I say, God, you got to show me the small picture too, though. You got to show me what it means to me, and you got to show me what it means to Richard and Felicia and Robert and Maria. I got to see what it means to the individual too. What does it mean to us, though? What does it mean to me in my life and my world? Can I get a witness?
Amen.
I want the world to be saved, but I want you to be touched, and I want me to be touched. I said, I need to see the small picture also. This new humanity. And I want to look at the big picture first. Listen to the big picture first. So if you're in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, Jesus himself, he said, this is why I'm here. He first began his ministry, the new humanity, the new priesthood, the Son of Man. He said, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. He has anointed me. He has anointed you to do what? To preach good news to the poor. I want us to see the big picture first. Preach good news to the poor. Listen, you and I have no problem finding the poor in our world. Once again, sometimes just look in the mirror. Sometimes you don't get to go so far. And you say, I want to help the poor. Let's look at the big picture first. You want to help the poor? You want to help the hungry? You want to help the thirsty? You want to help the cold and the naked? He says this. He says, preach the gospel. Preach the gospel. Preach the gospel. You'll give them something to eat, but he says before that, give them good news. You will save all of the poor. You will save them all by the good news. You want to give them something. Sometimes you don't have money to give. Sometimes you don't have food to give. Sometimes you don't have clothes to give. Amen. Can I get an amen? Sometimes my pockets are absolutely empty. But the big picture is this. Give them the gospel. Give them the good news. Tell them. Tell them about Jesus Christ, Son of God, Son of Man.
Yes.
Tell them about the tender and powerful compassion of their Creator and Savior. That is how we save the poor of the world. Know that. Before we send out piles and piles of food, God says you'll save the poor by preaching the gospel.
Amen.
Amen. True deliverance. True deliverance. Okay? Big picture. Preach the gospel. And Jesus says, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord has appointed me to preach good news to the poor. It says, to proclaim freedom to the prisoner. Go free some prisoners. And you know how to do it. Some people are tied up, bound up. I don't know. Sometimes, come on now. Sometimes we're the ones who tie them up. Let's just start there. We're tying them up. And you know how we tie them up? I'm going to tell you how you tie me up. You ready? This is how we tie them up. By control. By fear. By guilt. By unforgiveness. You are bound to that, at least in my mind. You want to make people feel guilty because they didn't do what you wanted them to do. You want them to get hurt because they did something to you, so you don't want to forgive them. You know? Whatever it might be that you have a certain control over them, and you know you have the power to set them free, you know you have the power to set them free. You have the power to forgive them. You have the power to love them. You have the power to hug them and say, it's okay, I'm okay. And he says, this is the gospel. He says, this is the new humanity. Gee, I think it's really the old humanity, but he says, this is it. He says, go set the prisoner free. Man, go set the prisoner free. Set him free. Set him free. We're going to go into the prisons and set them all free, the actual prison. Let's do that. Well, let's also, hey, listen, every one of us are jailers, man. Go open up some prison doors. Who do you have locked up today? Who do you have locked up today? Go set them free.
Amen.
Son of man. You are talking to you, son of man. You're human, right? Son of Man, go set him free. All right, good. And recovery of sight to the blind, release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, the year of Jubilee. Most of us in this room have heard about the year of Jubilee long enough where we know it's just the year where every debt is forgiven. I don't care what debt exists in this world, and I'm not talking about financial areas. God will guide you with that stuff too. He might, you know, but you know, sometimes we have such a carnal mind that we go to finances right away. For some reason we think, you know, money issues are God issues. They're not. The year of Jubilee, all debts are released. All slaves are set free. Everybody is entitled to go back to their own home. Those who are in prison, those who have to be slaves to pay up their debts. He said, everybody go home. Everybody go home to your family. Wow. The big picture of it all. Now, I like the John the Baptist. The John the Baptist, I believe he gave us a small picture of it. So, you know, you can just turn a chapter back. And John is in his ministry. Remember, he had a six-month ministry. I believe it's in the third chapter, if you're reading along. And when John was in the wilderness and he was, you know, preaching repentance and baptism, he said, the axe is already at the root of the trees. And every tree that does not produce good fruit, we will cut down and throw it into the fire. It's the absolute love of God. So the people around him might have got a little nervous. They said, John, I want to do it. He says, how do I want to do it? What should we do then? The crowd asked. What do we do? What do we do with a new humanity? What do we do? I can't get the big picture all the time. What's the little thing? What can I do in my world? And John says this. John answered, and he said, the man who has two tunics or two clothes or two shirts, two jackets, what does he say? He says, give one away. You got two pairs of shoes, give one away. You got two jackets, give one away. I know a lot of Muslims have done that before. What do? It's very simple. This is what you do. Small things first. Mm-hmm. He says, the one who has food, give it to someone who doesn't have food. Okay, great. We can do this in our world today. And then the tax collector also came to be baptized, and he said, teacher, he said, what are we supposed to do? What are we supposed to do? We're stuck in our jobs. We can't get out of our jobs. I want to quit the job and go into ministry. He says, tax collector, you can continue to collect the taxes. Oh man, what do they want to ministry? He says, keep your job. I have to say that loud and clear, because not everyone is this called to quit their job, okay? Just so you know. I'm not pinpointing anybody. God speak to your heart. So he says, keep your job. But he says, well, what do we do? I don't even like what I do. I think it's a rotten job. I think it's a dishonest service to people. So what's the answer? He says, don't collect any more than you're required to, he told him. He says, whatever you're doing, be the honest one doing it. Whatever you do, be honest in your trade. If everybody around you is lying and cheating, if this field you think requires to pinch a little, to do a little, he says, you don't. This is how you create a new humanity. You and your world, be honest. Amen. Be honest in your job. Amen. Be honest. You be the one that people want to come up to, like the mechanics. You never know a good mechanic. You're going to find a good mechanic who has heard the words of John the Baptist. And said, I'm bringing it to this mechanic. He's honest. Isn't that beautiful when somebody searches you out wherever you are in life because they know you're honest? Amen. Don't we all just look for honest people? I'm looking for a plumber or electrician. I just want somebody honest, first of all. Yes. Let me know who's not stealing from me. You first. Be honest. Amen?
Amen.
And then a soldier came, and he said, listen, I'm in the Roman army here, man. I'm in a real pickle. A soldier came. He wasn't even a Jew. He says, what am I supposed to do? Well, what should we do? He asked on behalf of all the soldiers. And John said this. He said, don't extort money, and don't accuse people falsely, and be content with your pay. That's a whole big mouthful, right? Oh, my goodness. Man, how that statement has transcended thousands of years since. Right. Be content with your pay. Stop complaining about what you're making, and stop bragging about what you're making. Stop talking about what you're making. Stop talking about what you're not making. This is not about that. And I think the greatest word there is this. Wherever you are in life, listen, the new humanity, listen, wherever you are in life, he says, be content. Be content. Listen, Jesus sees you wherever you are. And I know all of us think that Jesus has like a dozen, a half a dozen things that he's got to fix, right? And we all apply it to a natural realm, right? We got to get our house situation, our car situation, our job, our finances, our retirement. And the Lord says, it's the wrong realm. He says, I got you all covered. He said, he saw Zacchaeus. He sees you. He says, be content. I got you covered, man. Be content. You don't have to beg and plead and worry and doubt and steal and pinch to get by in life. Because that's not faith in God. And we all do it, and we all have done it. We say, God, help me as I go in. I'm going in, Lord. I'm going in. And we pray the favor of God. Relax. Don't even go in. Leave it alone. Have faith in God. Have trust his love for you. Whatever you find yourself, a tax collector, a soldier, whatever lot you find yourself to be in, he says, be content. Whatever status of life you are, be content. He's actually defined. And listen. If you are content, and if I am content, listen, I'm going to tell you, as a human race, we're going to stop stealing from people. We steal because we don't think we have enough. That's why we steal, because we're not content with what we have. That's why we steal. And
we're not Steve. I don't want to talk to there.
A little pinch, a little here and there. In whatever way. I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about we pinch a little way in our lack of trust of God. That's how we pinch a little. We pinch a little because we're worried, we're nervous, it's not enough, I'm not going to get by. Isn't this, I'm sorry, you don't have to answer this one. But I find this one to be like most of our conversation. It's about our life struggle and how there just isn't enough health, enough strength, enough money, enough love. And Jesus says, be content. He says, you call me son of God. He says, I call me son of man. That's how great you are. I see you as I saw Zacchaeus. I will take care of you. And this is how he begins with humanity. He's got to start with you first. And he says, you in your own little world, in your little world, you can do all these things. Wherever you find yourself. And then in the worldview, he says, just preach the gospel and save the lost. Amen?
Amen.
Now, I want to end with that, with the last thing, because I already read it for you word for word. But I'm going to turn there. When he first saw Zacchaeus, he says, for the Son of Man came to seek and save those who were lost. Listen, I'm going to say it again as we close. You are a son of man. You're human beings. He referred to himself as son of man. The purpose of the son of man, which means this, it means that you have divine purpose in this human life. You have divine purpose in this human life. Your humanity is empowered by the Spirit of God to do something. Your humanity is empowered by God to do something. And let's just take this verse here. It's to seek and to save those who are lost. Now, I know that we're all willing to save the lost, but I think in this passage here, he tells us to do this. And maybe God will work inside of us to do this. He says, seek him out. Seek him out. That's putting legs to compassion and love. Seek him out. Not if they come across our path. Not if we bump into them. Sometimes we want to bump into them, we'll still keep walking. He says, go seek him out. Go find somebody who needs help. Go look for somebody who's lost. Go to their house and knock on their door. Go make a phone call. Go find out where they are. Go visit them on the job site. Get out of your world for once and go visit somebody else in their world and go find them. Go find them. Go find them. And listen, I say this, there's not no guilt or shame. This is empowerment by the Spirit of God. This is for us all. Because he comes, he says, listen, Jesus says this. He says, I left heaven. What do you believe in? I left heaven to come down and find Zacchaeus. It's a million-mile journey. I know I got here in the blink of an eye, but it was a million miles. He left the halls of glory. He left his life of luxury to go and find somebody. Find somebody who cried out. Find somebody who was twisting and bending and trying to get your attention. There's people in your life, all over your life, who are trying to get your attention. Would you look back into their face? Would you look into their eyes? Would you go seek them out, maybe, and say, hey, you don't have to twist and turn. I came here for you today.
Amen.
I came here for you today. And although it seems like I've come under the guise of just hanging out, I'm not just hanging out. I came here for you.
Amen.
I came here to save you. love you, to open up the prison doors, and to set the captive free. Amen? Why don't you all stand and let the praise team to come forward. Praise the Lord. Bless you all. Now remember, whenever you hear the gospel, it's not that you got to go to do something, but I believe when you hear the gospel, it causes something to come alive inside of you that you want to go. I want to go and seek and to save those who are lost. I want to go open up some prison doors. I want to go set some captives free who I think I have a right to hold on. Amen. Well, we'll sing our song. We'll worship God. Spend time with God. You got three, I tell you all the time, it's a 3-minute song. See if you can find Jesus in a 3-minute song. All right? And then Brother Rich will close.